can taste the flavor of the fried curry leaf in this prawn right away. Some pepper, some coriander. That's a spirited prawn fry. That thick slice of Koshi's bakery bread. Just a perfect medium to carry forth that burst of sweet, salty, savoriness that you get in this tomato cheese toast. Hi folks, it's a beautiful day here in Bengaluru. The sky is overcast with clouds. It's not raining though. And this is the sort of weather that we in Bengaluru refer to as air-conditioned weather. When you step out, it feels like the city is naturally air-conditioned. And that's the sort of day that we have woken up to today. So today I'm on my way to the heart of Bengaluru's CBD, Central Business District. Well, today we're going to be tasting something different. We're not going to be tasting the idlis, vades, dosas that we've been doing for a while now, and also some of the traditional South Indian fare. We're on our way to Koshi's, an establishment that's been around for the last 80 years, and they are famous for a few things. So firstly, their all-day breakfast, and then some of their continental fare, whether it's liver on toast, roast chicken, and things like that. And plus, they also do some good Keralan food. So they do some appam and stew, they do, I think, a fish biryani. I don't know what things are like at Koshi's in the current scenario. So we're just going to go to Koshi's and take a look at what's happening and also savor some of the dishes that are on offer now. We've done an extensive episode on Koshi's earlier where we tasted most of their popular breakfast dishes. If you haven't caught that video yet, I'm going to place a link to it right here and also in the description below. Do take a look at it because we've also explored the history of Koshi's in that episode. So let's go to Koshi's and see what's cooking. Very different environment, of course, social distancing squares. So they're also taking details of the people visiting. So in case of an issue, they can always go back and trace. And also intimate people, I guess, if there's been a problem. Well, you would typically come here and, you know, take in these old photographs just to give you a sense of old Bengaluru. But of course, you have old Bengaluru now in the background, and in the foreground, you have all these measures that are necessary, I guess, to deal with life as it is today. Namaskar, Prem. How are you doing?
Very well, thank you. Thank you for coming.
A pleasure to be here. Very different circumstances. Yes.
Mother Nature is doing what no government, no United Nations could do. She's put us in lockdown. She needs to breathe. So I know it's a difficult time, but yes, this is something we have to go through. But we have to be careful and we have to distance. Yeah. So what our rule is, you put out your hand.
Okay.
Yes, this is a safe distance. Okay.
So that's the distance
this
that
the distance we should maintain always.
Okay.
Yeah. But in these cases, because of our mask sanitization and cleansing of the table, we hope that, you know, we can keep it contained, which is...
So what are some of the changes that you've done here?
You can see, two people per table, yeah. Everyone is just two and distancing, okay?
Alright. So earlier where four people would sit on a table, now only two can
only
sit
two
on
two on any table, yeah.
And I can see that your staff even is with masks.
Yeah, everybody has masks and gloves. And gloves. Yeah, all ready, set.
So typically when you would come here, you'd find a sea of customers in this beautiful old world setting, and you'd see servers scattered here and there. But today, I think there are more servers here than customers. That's what the current situation has done to most establishments today.
So as you can see, this is our pantry. Everyone has got their caps on. Okay, those are cooking. These people need to make sandwiches and all, so they're sanitizing regularly after each order. Yes, our heaters and all this are sterilized cups. They're going to be sterilized. Cooks are all distanced.
Of course, so, the last time we came here, we went in, we took a look at that, that bell metal coffee filter that holds the secret to the flavor of the coffee here.
That's right, it's still there. Yeah.
It's still there. I don't see the old coffee maker. 46 years. So he's been pouring the coffee here for 46 years. Wow.
Krishna Kuti had to go. Called home.
He's called home. And then of course we also saw the appam being prepared.
Yes, appam being prepared.
Same person.
Nayagam, yes. Nayagam is there.
Yeah, 25 years, appam.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember you.
Yes, Nayagam is there, our main chef man.
Is apam on the menu today?
Yes, we have a limited menu for now.
Okay.
Yeah, because apam is the fermentation process.
That's so
you
right.
can't play with that. So
That's right. It. You know, even in these difficult times, you still need a sense of purpose.
Yes, you know, that is the most important
That's
thing.
Right.
No, we need to have a sense of purpose. We are out there, we are working, because otherwise it's kind of crazy, no?
That's right.
And this is a new way of living is what we need to do. We need to move forward in the new way of living. Yes, which means we have to live pretty much obeying the laws of nature and trying to be in harmony with her, right?
That's right.
We have been actually destroying, we have been, you know, overcrowding, all of these things, overpolluting. So this is the natural way. We have to have a new order completely.
So there is a process of cleansing, but I guess nature has its way.
Yes, 100% of resetting. She's reset.
Oh,
we've been talking about it for so many hundreds of thousands of years. No, we do this, we will do that, we will calm the chair, we will do that. And in one swoop, in a month, she got the whole world to just go in, retreat, leave everything clean. Nature could rejuvenate and she's growing. So as a naturalist for me, this is one of the most normal events that has ever happened and could happen and will happen. We have to now, a new living, a new style of living is what we need to do. So what am I doing? We are in the service business.
Yes.
Yeah. So service is the most important. So that I think is the most, because we are putting ourselves at risk. My boys are putting themselves at risk, right? Coming out here and being in the service like a frontline worker or a doctor or a thing. But people have to eat, people need to be fed, right? We have to do it safely. We have to do it using the right type of products. Yes, we need to go back to using as many natural products as we can, organic if we can. You know, this whole thing has become a wake-up call. On one level, which is lovely. A lot of people have learned that they can eat stuff in their home.
Which also is not great news for restaurants.
It's not great news for restaurants, but hey, hello. You know, we pride ourselves of serving people three times a day. Most of our single people, most of our bachelors, most of our travelers.
But they're probably learning to cook now.
They have.
They have.
So, you know, I've had a couple of housewives call me and say, Prem, please share the recipe of the roast chicken. My husband insists that I make it just like Koshi's. Which I said, okay, now please bless us and come out, come safely, come have a roast chicken, okay? But yeah, this is as close as you can get. Here's the recipe, have it. So.
But then you have the energy of that kitchen that probably also feeds the recipe.
There you go.
For the last 80
All
years.
All of us, for our 80 years. That's true. Thank you so much for coming and blessing us.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to tasting.
Please.
Going back to some of my old favorites.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Prem. Thank you. So basically, you look at this menu, this is only for my use.
Yes.
And then dispose of it. All right. That's sensible, I guess. At a certain stage, you may say, well, you're wasting a lot of paper. But I guess in these times, you have to do whatever you can to minimize risks. So I want to do a combination of breakfast and lunch, right? Because it's 12:30. Still want to taste some breakfast dishes. Yeah, let's do the mutton omelette.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do the cheese and tomato toast. I tried that the last time too. And for lunch, do you have the biryani, the fish biryani?
Fish biryani is very nice.
So let's do the fish biryani.
Yeah.
Let's do the Kerala fried prawns and chili chicken. Well, coincidentally, this is the same table that we took the last time around too. I love this table because you can literally gaze out of the window. But when we were here the last time, it was a very different world that you were looking out into. Well, the food's on the table, so it's time, I suppose, to lower our mask, to lower our guard, whilst we derive some pleasure from what's on the plate. It feels strange to do that, but then times indeed are strange. That's the world that we live in today. Well, two of my favorite breakfast orders here at Koshi's. One is that mutton omelette. Basically, beaten egg seasoned with salt and pepper and rolled around some mutton mince. That's what the mutton omelette is all about. And then the toast. You have to do a toast when you come here. Thick slices of that Koshi's bread. And this one's topped with tomato, a pulpy, gooey tomato assemblage with some cheese on top. Time to get the party started. And I think I'm going to make a beginning with that tomato and cheese. A slightly messy affair. So that's all about the textures of tomato that you have in this dish. So you have fresh dices of tomato, and then you have some tomato sauce, homemade tomato sauce, and then you have that tomato that's been sauteed in a pan, which breaks down to a pulp
and releases its sweetness. So you have the sweet tartness of the tomato in this dish that's topped with the salty hit that you get from the cheese. And of course, not to forget that thick slice of Koshi's bakery bread. There's a perfect medium to carry forth that burst of sweet, salty savoriness that you get in this tomato cheese toast. You know, the simplest of dishes are usually the most satisfying. You take a thick slice of bread, toast it, slather on some butter, saute some tomatoes, get some of it going to a near pulp, top it on that toast and some shaving of cheese on top and place it under a grill. That's all that you need to come up with this tomato cheese toast. I'm gonna move on now to that mutton omelette. So the dishes here at Koshi's are quite simple, quite straightforward. They're probably the sort of dishes that were on the menu decades ago. But I think that's endearing about the food here. There's a certain simplicity in the food that resonates on your palate. You know, food doesn't have to be complicated. Food doesn't have to be pretentious. Food has to be simple and the sort that touches your soul and ignites a memory. And I think that's what Koshi's is to a lot of Bangaloreans who've been coming here over the ages. The mince is cooked just fine. It's cooked through where it appears dry, but it still has that moistness that you taste on the palate. That's a simple egg omelette. Take some eggs, beat it with some salt and pepper, pour it thin on a pan and then roll it around some mutton mince. The mutton mince too is delicately seasoned. It's a sort of mince that allows you to taste the flavor of the meat. There's no excessive masala, there's no chilies. Perhaps there's some pepper in there, some salt, and maybe some other spices. But all of them play a distant second fiddle as compared to the flavor of the meat. Because that's all that you taste here. You taste the flavor of that mutton. I'm gonna go back to that tomato cheese toast. The underside of this toast is now moist because all that pulp, all the juices from the tomato have in the last few minutes worked their way down this toast. And what that will also do is impregnate the toast with its tart sweet flavors. You know, when I came in, there weren't too many people, but now the place is beginning to fill up. And sometimes you wonder why people step out, right? I think they step out for a taste of the good old times. They step out for comfort food. And this tomato cheese toast is just that. It's a sort of food that takes you back to the memories of some happy times. That's so satisfying at so many levels. Well, I've got a few more dishes coming for my main course. But since I have this tomato cheese toast here and also the omelette, let's see what the combination tastes like. So that's interesting. The sweet tartness of the tomato is so all-encompassing that you barely register the egg and the mutton mince on your palate. So I think some things are best left on their own. So savor the tomato cheese toast on its own and the mutton omelette on its own. So that was breakfast and now we have our main course, lunch items. I think all three dishes I haven't tasted here before. So Koshi's of course is breakfast, is all day breakfast and then multi-cuisine, right? So you've got some Kerala dishes because I think that's what they do really well. And this is a dish that's been popular at Koshi's over the ages. This is a fish biryani that they do. I can't wait to taste that. And then you have a Kerala style prawns fry. I guess these are the tiny shrimps, so I'm expecting flavor. Not to miss the curry leaves. I'm sure there's plenty of pepper that goes into it as well. And then you have some chili chicken. This is the Koshi style Indo-Chinese chili chicken. Well, there's plenty of peppers, capsicum, onions. I'm sure there's some soy sauce that goes into it, dark soy. Well, I guess this is a typical chili chicken that you will find. You can also taste, I think, the sweetness of some ketchup that goes into it. This is a mild flavored chili chicken. You taste the flavor of the sauce more on the surface of the chicken and also in the onions and the vegetables and the capsicum. There's also plenty of garlic that you taste. It's tasty, but I wish the flavors of the sauce had permeated into the chicken a bit more. So is this the sort of dish that you would return to Koshi's for? Perhaps not. But then for that, you have that fish biryani, which they're hugely popular for, which I'm looking forward to tasting. I'm going to go all the way in, try to get some of the fish. Ah, so you have a steak of fish. I think this is the ayakora or the kingfish. And that is naped in some gravy. And that assemblage of that fish and that gravy is topped with some basmati rice. When you come to Koshi's, you can at times not only hear yourself, but also hear what's happening on your neighboring table. Depending on the decibel levels of your companions who are perhaps two tables away. And sometimes you feel that they're sitting right on your table, and that's what I'm feeling right now. So this conversation that's going on the state of politics in Karnataka, and also of course, Corona. But we're gonna try and not get distracted by that, and focus instead on our chicken biryani, on our fish biryani. I got distracted already. I said chicken instead of fish. How tastes that fish? So basically it's fish that's been fried first, and then that fish has been cooked in a gravy of sorts, which is then topped with the rice. I suppose the rice has also been tossed in that gravy, thereby allowing it to absorb some of the flavor. I am going to taste some of that prawn, that Kerala style prawn fry. The prawns are tiny. This is delicious. You can taste the flavor of the fried curry leaf in this prawn right away. Some pepper, some coriander. That's a spirited prawn fry. I love the sweetness of the tiny shrimp. I think I'm going to go back to that rice and this time also taste it with some of that prawn fry. That's a delicious prawn fry. I love the sweetness of the prawns that's cocooned in all the spices. You can taste the depth of flavors that emanate from the curry leaf, the pepper, the coriander. That's delicious. So just by itself, that biryani is tasty, but in a very different manner. So if you're looking for a typical conventional biryani, you need to expand your horizons because this is clearly not it. But it has all the components that would go into a biryani. You have the meat, which is the fish in this case. You have the spices that make for the gravy, and then you have the rice. But what makes it interesting is my side of that Kerala style fried prawn. This to me was a find from my meal at Koshi's today. Get that prawn with that curry leaf. I love the layers of flavor in that prawn. I almost forgot the salad or the raita. This is easily the sort of biryani that could happily feed two people, especially if you've tucked into some of the other sides here at Koshi's. You know, when you come to Koshi's, you have to change your mindset in terms of what to expect. Because Koshi's is not really about dining in the today. It's about feasting on dishes that were developed decades ago. So when you speak about a fish biryani, this is what a fish biryani meant for cooks who developed this recipe 30, 40, 50 years ago. And that's really what you will get on your plate here. And every once in a while, you'll stumble upon a delicious surprise like this Kerala fried prawns. Well, for some reason, I was craving some cake. And speaking of cake at Koshi's, it has to be the plum cake. So the plum cake at Koshi's is a tradition that goes back many years. In fact, Koshi's began as a convenience store and bakery in 1940. And this is the one cake that has earned for Koshi's fans, not just in Bengaluru and the country, but across the world. The cake is served year round, but come Christmas, there's a mad scramble to get your hands on one of these Koshi's plum cakes. If you haven't tasted the Koshi's plum cake, you certainly must taste it. It's not a plum cake that's as heady or intoxicating, if you know what I mean. When it comes to some of the very, very traditional plum cakes that are steeped in all sorts of alcohol, here the fruit is macerated, the fruit is steeped, but not to the extent that sometimes makes it a bit too bitter. So here you taste the sweetness and that slight bitter edge with some of the spices that go into the making of that plum cake. You know, even as I sip on my coffee and savor my plum cake and look at the world passing by through this window here, it feels like nothing has changed since the last time I stepped into Koshi's a few months ago. I think this space has a magical ability to transport us back to the good old times. After all, this is a space that's been around for the last 8 decades. And I think we all need that. We all need to find our escape back to some happier times, notwithstanding the challenges that we go through. And to me, Koshi's offers just a slice of that. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. Take care, take good care of yourself. And until the next time, happy eating.
If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!